Welcome to this new Inside Code video where we will talk about the depth first search algorithm. I want to start this video with an example. Let's suppose that you're reading a book about data structures and here is the summary. You're probably gonna read it this way. You go deep down into the first section until you finish it, then you move to the next section, you do the same thing, and so on. But you can see that a section has subsections inside it, so you have to do the same thing. You go deep into the first subsection, then the second one, the third one, etc. And subsections also have subsections, so to read the first subsection, you also need to do the same process. You read the first subsection, then the second one, etc. And this recursive process gets repeated until it arrives at sections that don't have subsections. So if you read this book, this is what's gonna happen. And basically, what you did here is depth first search of the book, because you went deep into the first section, then you went back to read the next subsection, then you finished them all, so you went back by one level to move to the next subsection, and so on until the end. All that because this book's structure has a tree-like structure, so what you did here is that you traversed a tree. Even if this process seems complex, you'll see that the code is very short. Let's say that a section is made of the content, which is a string, and an array subsections that contains its different subsections. So here is the function used to read this book. Read the section's content, then we call the function in each subsection. That's it, it's a recursive process. If you couldn't notice the recursion in the story, just imagine that the book you read is in reality two books, one about linear data structures and one about non-linear data structures. And that the linear data structures book is in reality four books, one on arrays, one on linked lists, one on stacks, and one on queues. And that the non-linear data structures book is in reality two books, one on trees and one on graphs. You probably got the concept now, so it's like you read 15 books. Now, let's see a second example. Let's suppose that you're at the blue point and you're really hungry, so you decide to eat in every restaurant in that area, and your strategy is to go as far as possible on the first path until you can't go further. Then you go back, you do the same thing with the remaining paths until traversing them all. Let's start. You're on the blue point and you go to the left to eat in restaurant La Mama. You continue and you eat in Le Comptoir. You keep going straight and you eat in Arte Cucina. Then you go to the left and you eat in California Cafe. Now you can go to the Perchoir. You continue and you eat in the Argentina restaurant. And now there is no way to go to another restaurant starting from here, so you just go back. Same thing here, you go back. Now you can go to the Argentina restaurant, but you already went to it, so you just go back. Same thing here, you can go to Argentina, but you already did, so you go back. No pass left here, you go back. And same thing here, you go back. Now you went back to your original position and you can now go from the second path, then the third one, then the last one. And this is what happens. These restaurants are in reality nodes of a directed graph, so we can say that we performed a graph depth first search. And to traverse a graph, we need a set to store the visited nodes, to avoid visiting the same node more than once and falling in cycles. And we also need an arbitrary node from where we start our traversal, because the graph has the particularity that we can start from anywhere. For example, here we started from that blue point. This is why our function takes two parameters, the node from where we start and the set of visited nodes. Now inside the function, if the restaurant is null or we already visited the actual restaurant, we just return because we don't even go to it. Else, we eat in the restaurant, we add it to the set of visited restaurants, and we call the function again on each adjacent restaurant. That's it. Now that we've seen these two examples, we can deduce that depth first search can be applied to trees but also to graphs. So let's see how is DFS applied to each one of them. For trees, the general idea is that we print the node's value, then we call the function again on each one of its children, because it's a recursive process. So if we decide to print values of this tree in depth first search, this is what happens. Note that this traversal is called pre-order traversal, because in a binary tree we can have all the traversals. We have the pre-order traversal, the one we did now, where we print the node's value, then we print the left subtree, then the right subtree. But we also have the in-order traversal, where we print the left subtree, then the node's value, then the right subtree. And the post-order traversal, where we print the left subtree, then the right subtree, then the node's value. The difference in code is just where we put the print statement, and here is an example to compare the output with each traversal. And for the graph, we follow the same logic, but we have two differences. The first one is that we have to determine the node from where we start, because in a tree, we always start traversing from the root, but in a graph, we can start from anywhere. This is why we need to know the initial node. Second difference, we need to put a set of visited nodes because we can have more than one path between two nodes. So to avoid traversing a node more than once or falling in cycles, we need to store the nodes that we already visited so that before printing a node, we check if we didn't already print it before. To illustrate graph DFS traversal, here is a graph that we will traverse starting from this node. And this is what happens. Now that we've seen how DFS works, I'm gonna answer two questions. First one, when do we use depth first search? We use depth first search when we want to traverse a tree or a graph. But you have to know that depth first search is not the only way to traverse a tree or a graph. We also have breadth first search, where we traverse the structure level by level. So the real question is to know what is the difference between them. And we will answer this question in the next video that will be about breadth first search. Second question, what is the difference between depth first search and backtracking? I think that there is no big difference between them. DFS is kind of a special case of backtracking. In other words, it's just backtracking applied to a tree or graph, because backtracking is a more general term. It can be applied in situations where there are no tree or graph. We can use it, for example, to solve the n-queens problem, where we deal with a matrix. Oh, and speaking of n-queens, if you want to learn how to solve the n-queens problem and 49 other ones, you can get the 50 popular interview coding problems course. It will help you to prepare for coding interviews and competitive programming, and it will also support the channel, so see the link in the description. Before ending this video, I want to tell you that you can find the code of depth first search algorithm in the description, so please give me your feedback in comments, like the video, and subscribe to the channel. See you in the next one.